Yeah, thank you. So welcome all to ITER. So my name is Anders Wallander. I'm head of the control division. Our responsibility is to provide a start button for the ITER machine, but also to take care of all the data. So I will briefly explain what ITER is about, give a background, what is needed to get the burning plasma, the role of the control system, a little bit about data, and also an update of the project status before making a summary. So there is a clear correlation between standard of living and usage of energy. So if we take some data, since we are here for data, we use the standard of living, we use the United Nations Human Development Index, which combines three metrics. So life expectancy, education level, and per capita national income. And we plot this against energy usage. We take from US Energy Information Administration statistics. So each dot on this plot corresponds to one country. And we can see also that the x-axis is logarithmic. And all Western countries are up in the top right corner. So we can easily do a fit here. And if we say we want all the world population to be above 0.8 index, so Western standard, let's say, then we need to increase the production of energy factor 1.6. So if we want to increase the standard of living of world population, we need to increase the production of energy. So here, what role could fusion play? fusion energy is very attractive because of three reasons. First, the fusion fuels are widely available, so it's basically seawater. There is no risk of any fission type accident, because if there's any disturbance in the process, it just turns off. And the fusion reactors produce no carbon dioxide and no high activity long-lived nuclear waste. So it's the holy grail of energy. Quite amazing, if we fuse 1 gram of fusion fuel, it corresponds to 8 tons of burning oil. So basically a plasma of 2 hydrogen isotopes are heated to more than 100 million degrees and are contained by strong magnetic fields. And then they fuse and it releases a neutron which interacts with a blanket on the vacuum vessel wall, which then can be turned into energy using conventional turbines. So it's all wonderful. So what are the technical challenges? So there is something called a Lawson triple product, which is a combination of temperature, density, and time. So those conditions have to be obtained in order for a fusion reaction to happen. And depending on what fuel you use, these conditions are different. So the easiest one is the one between deuterium and tritium, the blue curve here. So that's why this is the selected fuel. And this reaction has already been proven both in the US and UK in the 90s and again last year at JET in the United Kingdom. But the reaction has not, break even has not been achieved. So break even means that the output energy is larger than the input energy, and this is known as the Q factor. So with this background, the mission of ITER is to demonstrate the scientific and technological feasibility of fusion power for peaceful purposes. And the goal is formulated that it should produce fusion power of 500 megawatt with an input power of 50 megawatt. So it gives a Q factor of 10. And what is very important also is that ITER will never be connected to the grid. So the only deliverables from the ITER project is data. So we have to be sure that this data is not being lost or corrupted. So ITO is an integrated project. It has 7 members corresponding to more than 2/3 of the world population. And it's a very strong in-kind project. In-kind meaning that members don't give money, but they give systems. So this is politically very useful, but technology, it's a big challenge. Also, it has been decided that the approach to get to this final goal of fusion reaction has been staged. So there are different stages, which all includes an assembly phase, a commissioning phase, integrated commissioning phase and operation, and then another assembly phase where more systems and hardware is added. And then all this comes to a conclusion in 2035, when the mission should be, fulfilled. A little bit about the machine. So it's called a tokamak, which is the most common fusion device in the world. It basically works that there is an intense magnetic field generated by powerful superconducting magnets, which contains and shapes the plasma inside the vacuum vessel. So some numbers here. So the vacuum vessel is the donut you see in the center. It weighs 8,000 ton and is 850 cubic meter volume. It's surrounded by toroidal field coils, 18 of those, which basically the main function is just to contain the plasma so it doesn't touch the walls. And then in the center, there is a central solenoid. On the outer, you have a poloidal field coil, 6 poloidal field coils, which are used to drive the current and heat the plasma and shape it. And all this is contained in a cryostat, which is 30 meters diameter, 30 meters height. So if we look on the site, so this is a recent drone photo of the site, we can identify all the main parts. So you are at the right corner in the main headquarter building. At the very far end, we have the incoming electrical power. To the left, we have factories, which are used to manufacture parts which are too big to be transported. Then we have the cryo plant, which is responsible for generating the coolant for the superconducting magnets, so liquid helium, liquid nitrogen. And we have the power supplies, which generates the currents to the magnets. We have the assembly hall, where let's say pre-assembly is done before the components are moved into the tokamak complex, which is the core of the machine. And in the foreground, you have a heating system, which are used to generate additional heating to inject in the plasma. And in the very foreground, you have the heat reaction with a conventional cooling tower to react the heat. So if we go through all these systems, so the first one is electricity. Of course, we always need electricity, and this has to be distributed to all the clients. So the control system had to ensure that the right currents are flowing in the right place. So this started operation at ITO in 2019, and it continuously adding more and more load centers. So here we see some pictures of some commissioning activities. And this is a screenshot of a human-machine interface where we can see a geographical display of the site, where on the southern part, the power distribution is already completed and in operation, while at the northern site, there are still many more load centers to be added. Next, we need buildings and site services. So this is to control the environment in the buildings where we have all the equipments, but also to provide services like fire protection and a distribution of compressed air, demineralized water, etc. But this also started in operation in in 2020, and similar, it adds more and more building as we go along. Then we have cooling water, so we need to cool equipment all around the site, so there are these big pipes going around. So the control system need to control all the valves, pumps, etc., and regulate flows, pressures, and temperatures. So this started commissioning in 2020, and it's starting to serve the first clients right now. So this is again just a screenshot of one of these human-machine interface, where this was the first time cooling water was flowing through the cooling tower. Then we need cryogenic cooling, so the cryo plant, to generate, produce, and distribute liquid nitrogen and liquid helium. And again, here the control system has to control and monitor the production, so all the pumps and valves and the cold boxes, etc., in the plant, but also to distribute it to all the clients. And again, here we see just a photo of commissioning going on now, and data being produced. Then we need coil power supplies to generate the currents to the magnets. And again, here control system, this is an important system for the control system because it's the main actuator for controlling the plasma. So this is in construction, and commissioning will start in the next month. And then we have the vacuum. So a lot of this system requires vacuum, particularly the vacuum vessel. And again, here we need the control system needs to control and monitor all the pumps, valves, regenerate cryo pumps, regulate pressures, etc., etc. So this is in manufacturing and construction at the moment. Then we have all the structures, so the big mechanical structures like the vacuum vessel, cryostat, thermal shield, etc. So here the control system needs to monitor the properties of these structures, so vibrations, displacement, and so on. And then, of course, we have the magnets. So they are superconducting and also some conventional in-vessel coils. So here control system, again, needs to monitor temperature, coolant flow, mechanical integrity, and so on. So they are in manufacturing and construction. And then we need fueling. To create the plasma, we need fuel, so we need to inject fuel in the vacuum vessel. So again, here control system need to control this injection to inject the right amount of fuel at the right time. And this also is in design, manufacturing, and construction. Then we have the additional heating. So this is used to heat the plasma a bit more by injecting, say, radio waves or neutrons. So there are three heating systems, the ion cyclotron heating, electron cyclotron heating, and the neutral beam heating. So these are all in design, manufacturing, and construction. And finally, we need all the diagnostics. So these are all the instruments which measure the plasma properties, like current, density, temperature, shape, etc. And here, control system need to control and monitor the diagnostic themselves, but of course also to treat all the data which are being produced by this diagnostic. And these data are used for different purposes. They are used for, say, real-time feedback control. They are used for protection, and they are also used for scientific exploration. They are offline. But they are also in design, manufacturing, and construction. So the ITER control system takes all these different systems delivered in kind and performs the functional integration of the ITER machine. So it enables integrated and automated operation. So the key word here is integration. So remember that this in-kind procurement makes this very challenging. So just some brief slides about the control system architecture. So it's split in what we call three tiers. So the conventional control system, which is used for operation, the interlock tier, which is used to protect the investment for the machine, and the safety to protect both personnel and environment. And then we have, through two layers, we have a local system at the bottom and a central system at the top, which integrates all the local system. And again, here, the bottom part is delivered in kind by the ITO members, while the top part is in our control. And this is just a little bit more detailed about this architecture, which looks like any other architecture of any control system, where you have the sensors and actuators at the bottom and the human-machine interface at the top. So ITO is operated in pulse mode, meaning that a pulse lasts 100 milliseconds to 1 hour, and then there is a pause, and then you have another pulse, and so on. So this picture shows the global data flow, where the end user, the scientist, prepares his experiment by defining all parameters using what we call a scheduler. And this program, scientific programs, are stored in the scheduled storage. And then to execute it, the chief operation manager, so basically the chief operator, fetch the schedule from the storage and request it to be executed. And then the supervision and automation coordinates all different parts of the control system, prepare everything, and then plasma control system takes over the execution of the real-time plasma pulse. And continuously here you have a data flow produced, which goes out in archiving and in storage, and are made available for the the end user scientist again through a data access layer. And this is just a simple diagram where you see the main physical parameters at the top, so the plasma current and the current in some coils, etc. And at the bottom part shows the different components of the control system when they are acting and what they are doing. So if we go briefly through these main functions, so the first one is coordination. So we need to coordinate all these hundreds of local systems. In order to do that, we have a state machine, a common operation state machine. So every system have to adapt to this state machine. So you abstract all the uniqueness of each system, and from a high-level point of view, all systems look equal. And then we have the configuration, so we need to deal with a huge amount of configuration parameters, which has to be specified and then downloaded to all the systems before execution. And we have synchronization, so we have to be sure that all systems are at the same time and synchronized. So we use PTP protocol for that in order to distribute an absolute time to everyone, which is the basis of all this synchronization. So this is in the 50 nanosecond range. And we need to sequence, so we need to sequence the operation. And again, we have a sequencer to make sure that actions are executed in the right sequence. And of course, in a control system, there is feedback control everywhere, from a local level to a more higher level. And the most complex one is the plasma control, where we basically use diagnostic data as sensors, which are processed in different ways, and then various controllers are applied, and then the actuators are mainly the coil power supply, so to adjust the current in the coils, the fueling to inject more fuel, and this additional heating system. And then, of course, we have data handling. Again, ITO only delivers data. So this, say, multi-billion project only delivers data. So data is extremely important. So we need to collect, acquire, collect, archive, and give access to this data. So all archive data are stored in HDF5 format. And then we need to ensure, we need to really ensure that this data is not lost or corrupted or anything like that. Again, this is just some architecture of the data archiving and data access system, where the raw data on this left picture are coming from the top. And then it's using Gluster to store the data in files, HDF5 files, and then different ways to access this data. So basically an API which allows you to use your favorite tool to process the data. And then of course we have also important is real-time visualization. So this is just some examples where to the left you have a camera view into the vessel. So you can see here the interaction of the plasma with the wall. While on the right you have a reconstruction of the plasma shape. And also some animation of the coils in the different currents, currents in the different coils. Okay, so just to give some main parameters of the control system. So the main characteristics of this control system is it's very big. Maybe it's not, there are other control systems which are more demanding from a performance point of view. But the size here is the main challenge. So we talk about thousands of what you call the cubicles or racks. We talk about hundreds of thousands of sensors and actuators. And we talk about many millions of say process variables, which is a data point in the control system. If we look at some metrics, so one metric is we can define a metric when we energize an INC rack. So for the first plasma, we estimate there will be 1,500 such racks energized. And today we have about 200. So we are starting on this curve, but the shape is changing. So we have challenges ahead. Huh? Similar, we can also measure the number of integrated process variables. So that's any data point in the control system, which can be a sensor or an actuator, but it can also be a calibration factor or some computed value and so on. So again, here for the first plasma, so the first stage, we estimate to have more than 3 million of these process variables. And today we have something like 700,000. So again, we are moving forward, but we are still at the start. So I want to conclude with some pictures from recent assembly activities, because it's very spectacular. So this is just a picture early this year in the assembly hall. So what you can see here is at the bottom right, you can see one of the toroidal field coils. And at the top left, you can see a special tool which is used to pre-assembly a piece before it's being lifted into the main place in the tokamak pit. So this tool to the left takes one vacuum vessel sector. So the vacuum vessel is split in 9 parts. So each sector is 40 degrees, so the total vacuum vessel. And then two toroidal field coils are fitted outside this, and a thermal shield to help protect the huge temperature difference. Remember, in the vacuum vessel, we talk about plasma at more than 100 million degrees. And in the coils, we talk about liquid helium at 4 Kelvin. So you cannot have bigger temperature differences. And this is just a picture of one of these sectors where you see 4 workers preparing this work. And here we see a look down in the tokamak pit. So this is where the machine will be installed. So there are many pieces at the bottom here which are already installed, but the main part is still missing. So a few weeks ago, we had a big event, which is called the Big Lift. This was the first out of 9 subsectors. So again, one ninth of the vacuum vessel, together with 2 toroidal field coils and a thermal shield, was lifted and installed in the tokamak pit. So here we see to the bottom left, just a funny visualization, a 3D visualization of the crane position when it moves. And to the right, just a time series where we see the positions of the crane and the loads when this happens. And it's quite impressive, the oscillation of the loads when the crane works. So this is 12,000 tons of weight. And here is the last picture when it's just going into the final position. So it's being lowered down there from there to the final position. So I will just conclude that ITER can contribute to secure future energy supply. The construction, Taos First Plasma, is 75% complete. The ITER control system is in design, construction, commissioning, and operation in parallel. And ITER is producing HDF5 data today, maybe not so fancy data because it's only glow time series, but still it's producing HDF5 data. Thank you.
I don't know if there is a question in the audience or remotely. So we start remotely. I don't know if remotely you have questions. Raise your... I don't see anything. A little bit in advance, actually, because
can you hear me? Perfect. I was wondering, when you say that there is a lot of in-kind contribution for the control system, that means that probably all the devices together with the control units are coming by some suppliers, and you have to integrate it together with your system. Do you also expect that they are already storing something in HDF5, or you are getting the data and reformat it, transfer it into HDF5 yourself?
Yeah, the latest. So this integration relies a lot on standardization. So we have catalogs of devices you can use and so on for the control system, but it's the lower level, and then the data comes out from this, and in the back end, it's converted to HDF5, which is fully in our control.
Thank you.
Could you answer, please?
Well, we are roughly around 500 gigabytes. But we have, as Anders said, we were in production since 2018. So, yeah, and it's mainly slow data.
what kind of software we use for the control system. Yes. Yes, yes, we're EPICS based. So EPICS is the core of everything, yes. What? No, I don't know what it is, so we don't use it. To ask Lana.
Well, there are two things actually, because HDF5 is self-described, and the second thing is the ITER lifetime is a very, very long project. So we wanted to make sure that we have a good data preservation, and this is not easy to find a format which can stand that time.
Actually, this was quite interesting because there is a fusion community which use a kind of standard format, which we decided it's not sustainable because it's a very small group of people maintaining that. And I think that was one struggle at some point. So there was a strong pushback from this community that why does ITER not use what is most common in the fusion community? But I think it's already turned out to be a wise decision. Well, first, maybe I can get my view, because I like to look on data. I don't care what the data is. I just want to see what it is. And again, this is a simple data. Again, very slow time series, so it cannot be simpler. But still, it's very important for the commissioning and so on to prove that things work. So Lana produced an API and made some templates, and then I just use that, and it always works. That's the only thing I can say. Yeah, I think, yeah, so ITER, of course, is very important in the fusion community because it's the biggest experiment. So I think it's right that more and more people also in this community is looking at this, yes.
No, so as Anders said, there is no intermediate format, so we have sensor. Then we have some computer which actually stream the data. Ah, sorry. Okay. Well, I'll remove the mask. Okay, nobody from safety is here. So, can you hear me? Yes. Okay. So, yes, so as Anders said, we have sensor. Then we have some computer which go into format the data and then stream the data to some archiver and then store it to HDF5. But there is no intermediate file format in between. Ah, we have some question from the... So we have a question about compression.
So, this is a very good question. This is something we are going to investigate hopefully by the end of the year and next year when we will get our first infrared and visible camera. So this is something under investigation, so I cannot give any answer now.